May the peace of Christ be with you. Today we'll be reflecting on Matthew chapter 20, beginning from verse 1 to 16. The Jews knew that they are the chosen race, and because of this, they took salvation for granted. There are a few reasons or a few things I'd like to share with you about this kind of notion. You know, erroneously, they thought that salvation was their, you know, birthright. Secondly, by implication, they had no need of striving, of trying even to live good life. Number three, this issue of spiritual tepidity was very obvious among them. Number four is that there was some sort of moral laxity in their lives. Then finally, we see that they became so lazy because they thought that they did not need to struggle to have eternal life. Jesus, in the parable today that he gave us, reminds us of some few truths. Number one, Jesus gave a lesson, and not just a lesson, but a warning, both for his own people and for his disciples, so that in Christianity, we don't need to, you know, feel or try to show that we are senior to anyone. Every person is honorable in the eyes of God. There are a few things also I like us to think about in the parable that Jesus gave. The first thing is that creation is entirely the work of God. That's the first truth that we see. And God has absolute ownership over the entire creation. The second thing is that God loves everyone equally, and every one of us is precious in the eyes of God. There's nobody that is more precious than the other. No, all of us are equally precious in the eyes of God. The third point is that God cares for all. He cares for all. He thinks about everyone, and he knows each and every one of us by names. He knows where to find us. As you can see from the parable, the master, the landowner, went out many times, beginning from the sunrise, which is 6 a.m., to 9 a.m., to 12 noon, to 3 p.m., and then to the 11th hour. He knew where to find each of the laborer because God knows our address. He knows our location. He knows our names. He knows everything about us. Number four is that God loves us, and his love for us is universal, irrespective of where we come from, irrespective of our past mistakes, irrespective of, you know, our weaknesses, our limitations and shortcomings. He loves us. You know, our holiness or sinfulness does not determine God's love for us, because God's love for us is unconditional and it is independent of our sinfulness or our holiness. Okay, the next thing I'd like us to reflect on is that the generosity of God is boundless. It is unlimited. It's unfathomable. The final thing, the fifth thing I like us to reflect on is that God has opportunity for both the Jews and the Gentiles. He has opportunity for both the saints and the sinners. God has, you know, ample opportunity spaces for every one of us. So we don't need to get envious of the other person, because each and every one of us, we have our own space in the heart of God. The heart of God is so magnanimous that he has room for everyone. God is compassionate. God is full of tenderness. He knew that if these persons who were at the 11th hour did not get any job, he knew that their family were going to starve. He knew about their economic situation, because if eventually these guys did not get any, you know, anyone to hire them, it means that that day the whole family will go hungry. That was the implication. So God knew about that. So this is very important for us to see. There is no one without a blessing from God. That's the next thing I like us to think about. There's nobody without blessings from God. But what we do with these blessings that God gives to us is what matters. What we do with those blessings. So what we do with them is what makes us chosen race or chosen for salvation. It's not about what he has given to us, but it is about our response to what he has given to us. The way we use the things he has given to us, that's what makes us chosen, and that's what prepares us as candidates for salvation. There are a few other things that I admire in this parable, and that is, the first thing is that it doesn't mean how many years one has been a Christian. In fact, Jesus was telling this parable to his disciples to make them have open mind, because in the latter years, people are going to come from all parts of the world to become Christians. So this parable was a parable given by Jesus to prepare their mind that they may have that openness, open-mindedness in welcoming, in accepting, in accommodating those who will come from the east, from the west, and from the south. So this was very, very important in the mission of Christ. So it doesn't mean how many years one has been a Christian, because sometimes we have this tendency that people say, oh, I have been a Christian before you, so I know God better than you. It's not true. Nobody knows God better than the other, because it is God who reveals himself to us the way he chooses to reveal himself. So it doesn't mean how many years one has been a Christian. What matters is our loyalty, our obedience, and our acceptance of God's will. Someone may have been a Christian for 100 years, but it only... he or she may have accepted God's will just for 1 year. But the one who has become a Christian only for 5 years accepted God's will for the whole 5 years. So we don't know, and we cannot judge one another how close we are to God. Only God knows that. And we have no right to, discriminate against another person because the person became a Christian after we have become Christians for a long time. So everyone has a mission irrespective of one's expertise. We all have a mission in God. Number three is that I admire the perseverance of these persons who were called at the 11th hour. I admire them because it is easy for us to give up, especially in the moments that, it seems as if nobody cares about us, people don't remember us. It's easy for us to give up. But these guys refused to give up. They persevered. They were committed until at the 11th hour that the landowner invited them to come and work. So, we are all invited. Our creation is an invitation from God to work. That's why in the beginning of creation, God said, go and beautify, go increase and multiply. This increase and multiply is not just about procreation, but it's about us being workers, in the vineyard of God. And in the vineyard of God is the world. So we are called to work, not to become lazy. Okay, so the next thing I like us to reflect on is they were called at the 5 p.m. It is God who calls us into blessings. We are not the ones calling God into blessings. It is God who calls us into blessings. And he can call us even the time we least expected it. That's the 11th hour. I also admire the sincerity of those who grumbled. I admire the fact of, them complaining or comparing themselves or grumbling. No. But the fact is that I admire their sincerity, because many of us grumble inside. We keep malice, we keep grudges, we keep resentment, we keep that envy inside us, and it's burning inside us, it's becoming bitterness and, hatred and all kinds of things you can think about negative. But these guys were able to express themselves. I think when we begin to express ourselves, we may receive help. But when we just bottle it up, we keep on, being depressed, and our life become miserable. So I admire the fact that these guys were very expressive. They were able to say what they were thinking about. And Jesus, in that story, shows that God corrects us. He corrects us. Okay, so the next thing I like us to really reflect on is that to remember the world is big enough for everyone. You don't need to get envious of another person. Envy comes in when we refuse or when we fail to recognize our own blessings as we pay more attention to the blessings of other persons. All of us are blessed. So, but when we pay attention to the blessings of other persons, we fail to recognize our own blessings. The world is so big to accommodate everyone. So why do we need to be jealous of other persons? Why? We don't need to be jealous of other persons. So, every person is unique. There's something I wrote here I like to read for you. Don't be insecure about the gifts of other persons. And you don't need to start comparing yourself with others, because we are all unique. You are unique and your blessings are unique, because your mission is unique, as you have a unique place in the heart of God. This is so beautiful. You are unique and your blessings are unique, because your mission is unique and you have a unique place in the heart of God. I want you to remember that. So let us pray for Christians who have become, so arrogant because of their number of years as Christians. You know, we need to appreciate one another irrespective of the time the person became a Christian. Stop looking down on other persons because you became a Christian before them. It doesn't matter how many years you have been a Christian. What matters is how much you have been able to love all these years. So, I like to reflect finally on why did these people complain. Number one is that they were overconfident. Number two is because of their inordinate expectations. We get hurt when we have so much expectations from God. And that's why many of us are crying, oh, God is not answering my prayer. It's not because God is not listening or he doesn't want to answer our prayers. He may have answered your prayers, but because you have a certain expectation, that's why you think your prayers have not been answered. Number three is that they have this intergenerational arrogance. And number four is that they have this superiority, you know, complex. Okay, God has space for you even at your 11th hour. So don't give up on yourself. Life is an opportunity even until the last second of it. Your life is an opportunity until even the last second of your life. Don't give up because God will never give up on you. He will surely reach you that time you least expected his coming. Remember that. As Christians, we should not work for pay, but we should work for the joy of serving the Lord. Use your three T's, your time, your talent, and your treasures to serve the Lord. Enjoy. And you will see how God will reward you. You don't need to dictate for God what he should do for you because God knows what is good for you. I am Reverend Father Evaristus Asado, and I wish to invite you to subscribe to my YouTube channel that you may see many of these kind of homilies and reflections. God bless you.